on God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty.
Father, we praise you, we magnify, we glorify you. You're awesome in this place. Holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord. Holy is our God. Holy is our King. He is the ruler of everything. Hallelujah. We worship you. We praise you, mighty God. Come and have your way. Have your way in our lives. Can you have your way in us as a church, as a family? And Father God, we just pray and we ask, have your way in this meeting today. And Lord, I thank you, Lord, that your will be done, your kingdom come, in Jesus' name. We thank you for your word. As we break open the bread of life, we thank you for the spirit of revelation and wisdom, that we might come to know you. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. God bless you. Excellent. May need a glass of water too, please, Peter. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. All right, beginning a new series this morning. Called Ambassadors of the Kingdom. Ambassadors of the Kingdom, part one. And if you know who I am, you know that I love to preach the kingdom. The kingdom is my thing. I think about other ministers. They have their own strengths. Papa Hagen used to, his strength was in faith. Papa Hagen preached faith. He said one time, a person stood up in his sermons and he says, "You're not preaching the whole counsel of God." And he replied, "I don't know the whole counsel of God." And then we get Kenneth Copeland, for instance, his specialties in prosperity. And then you've got Oral Roberts, who's in faith healing and miracles. And so I seem to gravitate around the kingdom. Kingdom seems to be a specialty, if you like. Praise the Lord. So Ambassadors of the Kingdom, Ambassadors of the Kingdom, part one. And so when we look at the kingdom here in the Word, it talks about the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. And immediately we can come to a misunderstanding that we think the kingdom of heaven has only become apparent to us when we leave the earth, or when we go into eternity, or whether we enter into the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God after we pass away. And just turn with me, please, to our base scripture here in Colossians 1 and verse 13. Colossians 1 and verse 13. Got it, say got it. Colossians 1 and verse 13. All right, Colossians 1 and verse 13, it says, "He," with a capital H, meaning whom? God. "He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love." Verse 14, "In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins." So he has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed. Now that word conveyed is translated, the King James Version actually says translated. He's translated us from the power of darkness into the kingdom of the Son of his love. But in the Greek is the word methestame, which means to carry away, to transfer, to put out, to remove, to translate, to turn away. See, we're over here for some of us who are born in the world, raised in the world. We were in this kingdom. But when you became born again, God had carried you away, transferred you, turned you away from one kingdom and placed you into another kingdom. Kingdom of the Son of his love. Amen. Praise the Lord. And so that word power, that word power is the word exousia. Exousia, which means mastery, magistrate, token of control, jurisdiction, or delegated authority. See, we were under the power of darkness for a number of times. You were under its control. The people that don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, they are still under the control of darkness. That's why we shouldn't be shocked at what the world does, because they're under the control or dominion of darkness. You following me? Okay, they are under his magistrate, they're under his mastery. It's quite interesting, when Jesus was tempted by the devil says, all this authority has been given to me. All this authority has been given to me. He showed Jesus all the kingdoms all at one time. He goes, I'll give this to you if you bow your knee and worship me. And so he's showing all these kingdoms all at one time, and he says, all this authority has been given to me. Who was it given? Who gave it to him? Man, exactly. When Adam bowed his knee, and when Adam took that fruit, the forbidden fruit, he bowed his knee to the evil one and gave him the authority. Powerful stuff. And so people in the kingdom of darkness, and under its mastery, under its magistrate, and under its token of control, they're under the kingdom of darkness. Now, I want to also highlight the word darkness here, okay? So he has delivered us from the power of darkness. This word darkness means obscurity. Obscurity. Darkness. Obscure means to hide something. To hide something. And we were once walking in obscurity. We were hidden from truth. I remember growing up, this is for everybody, we kind of believe that this is all the world is. What we see, what we smell, what we taste, what we touch, what we hear, this is how the world is constructed. We see the leaves on the trees, we see the grass outside, we see the car park out there that's been nicely laid by a great man. And then when we turn 5, you go to school, and we're educated in the sense realm stuff, in the cosmos. We understand how things work here in the cosmos, in the sense realm. But we're obscured from truth. We obscured, things are blind, the seen world has pulled the blinds over our eyes from what truth is. And when you get pulled out of this kingdom and brought into the kingdom of light, because by faith we receive his grace into salvation, the blinds have been pulled back. And we get to see some things now. There is this whole realm, this whole spiritual realm that is out there that is real. It is more real than what is the seen realm. It's quite interesting here, Matthew 16. Just write this down, Matthew 16. Jesus commended Peter. He asked him, he turned around and asked him a question. He's go, who do people say that I am? Some think you're John the Baptist, some think you're Jeremiah or one of the prophets. He goes, what about you? Who do you say that I am? And Peter answered correctly. He says, you are the one true Son of God. You are the Mashiach. You are the one we've been waiting for thousands of years. You're him. Powerful, powerful interaction. So Jesus says this to Peter. He says, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. He wasn't going off by what he saw. He wasn't going off by what he could smell. So listening to Andrew Womack, he says, you know what? Jesus probably smelled bad. They back in ancient Israel, they didn't wash like we wash every day. Still training my boys to. They think it's an unnecessary waste of time sometimes. But when you're looking at the humanity of Jesus and you're standing there looking at this, it wasn't revealed to Peter by his sense realm stuff. This was revealed to you by my Father who is in heaven. Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. Gates can do two things. Gates can keep things in, if they're shut, and gates can keep things out. Now, if I was in charge of the gates of Hades, the people that I want to keep in Hades are people that are obscured, people that are in the kingdom of darkness. And who would I want to keep out? Us. The kingdom of light. The kingdom of light. You are correct. And so it won't prevail keeping us out. Now, pretend that exit sign there says Hades instead of exit. And so when you become born again, you move from one kingdom, you almost get thrown out into the kingdom of light, the Son of His love. And the gates of Hades slammed shut on you, because the devil doesn't want you back into Hades. But the gates of Hades cannot prevail. Oh, I could almost bust this. Better not. The gates of Hades cannot prevail against the church from going back in there and setting free more believers. In fact, that's what the Great Commission is. I want you to go out into all the world, which is cosmos. I want you to go into Hades and preach the gospel. Are you understanding what I'm saying? And so the gates of Hades won't prevail. You see, we read this and we think it's a defensive thing. Oh, the gates of hell won't hurt us. No, we won't keep us out from hurting Hades. You understand what I'm saying? It is an offensive scripture. We are meant to go out into the world and expand God's dominion. We're meant to take ground. We're meant to occupy the land. Are you with me?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So the gates of Hades do two things. They keep things in and they keep things out, but the gates of Hades shall not prevail against the church. The church is in there. We're in Hades, setting people free. But in Hades, the ways or the kingdom of darkness is to keep people obscure from the truth. It hides truth. In fact, when you confront people with truth, they don't want to see it sometimes. They like the darkness. It's quite interesting, in the 1930s, people born into the Depression thought that lining up for food was normal. It was normal to life. They thought hopelessness was normal to life. This is just the way that we live. I remember listening to this education. My principal, when I was working at a school, he came back from this professional development, and he said he was listening to a judge, and he was talking about the state of the nation. And he says, there are two dads sitting out there in the world. He said, there is one dad who's sitting there. He's on this. He's at his beach house in Whangamata with his son, sitting out on the deck watching the sunset. And he says, son, if you want all this, you get good grades at school, you study hard at tertiary education, you get your master's degrees, and get your degree with honors, and I'll introduce you to the right people, and you can have all this. And then you get another dad who's sitting on a pile of tires in his garage with his son, getting ready for the Friday night booze up. Got the box of beers sitting on the bench. And he says, son, if you want all this, you work hard, you save up for the weekend, and then you party hard. Two different levels of life. And sometimes we grow up to believe that this is what real life is, and that this, where we're at right now, is normal. But being in the kingdom of the light, of the Son of His love, takes away that obscurity, takes away the hidden things, and there is a higher level of life to be lived as kingdom people. You following me? And so there are these levels of life that people settle for because they just can't see beyond it. It has been obscured. When I was teaching at Mangakahi Area School, the kids that grow up there, that's all they see is the valley. They can't seem to be able to get past it. And I was successful with a number of students. I sat with a number of students and I says, look, you've got to look beyond this. I'm not saying the valley's bad or farming is bad or anything like that, not by any means. But for some, it's a place of poverty. There are kids that are living there that with boarded up windows, and they're still living in the houses. There is no running water in some places there. They have to wash in creeks. And they think, this is my life. This is just the cards that I've been dealt with. They've been obscured from truth. And so I've tried to reveal some true things. I says, where you've come from doesn't define who you are. It is your choices that you make. You can choose right now as to how you will end up. And I said that in my farewell speech as I left after 13 and a half years. And it's for the first time the whole school was silent. Usually I'm having to tell students to shut up. And so I said to them, it is the choices that you make. And one of my students, I sat there at a computer and I says, well, let's log in all the credits that you've got so far. And boof, all these career options came up, and one of them was a pilot. And I said to him, I said, his name was Adam. Adam goes to me, he goes, oh, I'd quite like to fly planes. I go, well, let's pursue that then. Sure enough, he went on from Munkay Area School, went down and got his pilot's license. I think the last time I spoke to him, he was provisionally given a license where he needs to fly 2 years before he can fly commercial planes. Amen. And so I saw him in the gym one time, and I said, dude, I'm believing God. He's not even a believer. But all my kids knew that I loved the Lord, and they knew where I was at because I'm not ashamed of the gospel. So I said to him, I was going, oh, I'm believing God for a jet plane where I fly around the world and minister the gospel. And I said, but I'll need a pilot. He goes, yeah, man, I'll help you fly around the world and we'll preach the gospel together. He hasn't even received Jesus as Lord and Savior, but he's wants to fly me around. Praise the Lord. But Hades wants his captors to be obscured from the life beyond it. They want to hide the kingdom. They want to hide. He wants to hide his kingdom. And so we've been brought from one kingdom and put into another. We're brought from one jurisdiction and been put into another's jurisdiction. And there is a turning away from one kingdom to face and embrace another. The problems and the issues lie is when we try and grab the way that we do things here in this kingdom and pull them into the church. And it just doesn't work. There is a letting go of, turning away from, and embracing the way that God does things. So to increase in this kingdom, for instance, is that you save your money and you invest your money and you accumulate wealth, even if you have to lie, cheat, and steal to do it. There has to be a letting go of that and embracing the way that God prospers in this kingdom. That is to give. And there has to be some rewiring that needs to be done up here. You understand what I'm saying? We have to kind of change the way that we think about things and the structural thinking and thoughts. And so there are two rulers in each of these kingdoms. There are two rulers in each of these kingdoms. There are two ways of progressing in each of these kingdoms, and they are different. They are different. I want to have a look at this interaction more closely between Jesus and the devil. So let's turn with me to Matthew 4 and verse 1. Matthew 4 and verse 1. Make sure you bring your word. I notice some people aren't turning their Bibles. We've got some down the back if you don't have one, but make sure you get one. This here is the most important thing you'll ever read in your whole entire life. If there is a key to life, I am holding it in my hands. Praise the Lord. It's good for you to look at the words themselves. It is life to you. It is health to your bones. It's life to your flesh. Praise the Lord. In keeping of it, there is great reward. Read your word. Read scripture. Matthew 4. Are we there? Yes. Verse 1. Here we go. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Now, I just want to point something out here. God never tempts anybody with evil. He cannot. But it says here he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. What I've noticed is that Jesus had to overcome things and surpass things that we will never have to. He had to be tempted by the devil. There were some spiritual laws, some spiritual things that had to take place in order for us to be free. So Jesus was tempted by the devil so that we will never have to. It says in Corinthians, there's always a way of escape. Isn't that awesome? He was forsaken. Remember what he said on the cross? Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? He was forsaken so that you will never have to be. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will not leave you orphans. I will be with you until the end. We've got to understand that his sacrifice on the cross was more than... We won't know it fully until the age to come. Praise the Lord. So in verse 1, he was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. The devil is real. He is an angel. He is not omnipotent. He's not everywhere. One of his biggest lies, one of the obscure things that he likes to do here in the cosmos, in the kingdom of darkness, is to say to people, I'm not real. I don't actually exist. You can just keep living the way you want to live. There won't be any punishment. Any consequences. But the devil is real. To be tempted by the devil. Verse 2, and we're going to read verse 3 as well. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, afterward he was hungry. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread. He's basically saying, use your miraculous powers to supply ordinary and personal needs at your command. Prove it. He even tried to distort and confuse his identity. If you are the Son of God, you think you're the Son, prove it. Show me. You're hungry? The stones right here, turn them into bread. Show me. Prove it. Trying to bring confusion and distortion to his identity. We even see that today. I notice now when I'm filling in forms, there's not just male and female anymore. But my Bible tells me male and female, he created them. Amen. That's it. There is no non-binary. This. I'm not even going to go into the list of hundreds of options that you can choose from now. But this question got brought up in the Ministers Association meeting about this community that is being created as we speak. And we have to ask ourselves, what if somebody from the trans community or someone from this alphabet group decide to come in here into the church? Now you have to remember, we don't hate the people. It's the sin. And I said, this is what I said to a number of pastors, because they wanted to hear what my opinion was. And I said, as far as that community goes, they're welcome to come into church here and hear the word. But to enter into this kingdom, they have to repent just like everybody else. There is no secret pass for one person as there is for another. The way from this kingdom to that kingdom is repentance. There is no other way around it. If I have to repent, if I have to let go of the cosmos to come in and embrace the things in the kingdom of light, then so do you. But we don't hate them. Remember, they're in Hades right now. They're obscured from truth. Praise the Lord. And so the devil here tries to confuse Jesus about his identity, tries to distort it. It's quite interesting over here, you know, the common thing is, I believe it when I see it. But that's not the way of faith. Even the way that you've entered into the kingdom is by faith. You believe that Jesus had died on the cross. You didn't see it with your own eyes. You just believe it in your heart. And what was awesome about that is that the Holy Spirit on the inside of you somehow triggered and knew that it was true. I know that this Jesus is real. And it just seemed to give you a peace. And he says, you know what, Lord, I'll give you all that I have. I lay down my ambitions, I lay down my dreams, I lay down my values. What you have, I'll take. It's quite interesting. When Jesus was resurrected from the dead, he appeared to his disciples. But Thomas was having a hard time accepting that Jesus had risen from the dead, even though Jesus had told them multiple times, the Son of Man must be handed over to the Pharisees and the Sadducees, he will be executed, and then on the third day he will rise again. Obviously, Thomas didn't kind of connect up. And so he says to his brothers who are in the room together, he goes, look, if I can put my hands in his marks, if I can stick my hand into his side, then I'll believe. And Jesus shows up. Peace. I don't know, if Jesus just appeared, I'll be thinking, rot-row. I've probably said some things I shouldn't have. He goes, Thomas, put your hands here. Put your hand on my side. He says, you are the Son of God. He goes, you say that because you've seen me, Thomas. But more blessed are they that don't see but believe. And I'll tell you who I'm talking about. I'm talking about everybody that's sitting here in this room. You didn't see it with your own eyes, but somehow you've made the transition from one kingdom into another because you believe it. Praise the Lord. So faith is outside the sense realm. Faith is outside the sense realm. Let's go to verse 4. This is how Jesus responds. And he says, it shall be written that it is written that man shall not live on bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Man shall not live on bread alone, but every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So the kingdom of God, we don't survive on food alone. It cannot sustain us. You can fast it if you desired. Hands up here who's done some fasting before. Praise the Lord. You give it up. We don't need to live on you food. We can fast. But we live on God's word. We live on God's word. It's outside of hard evidence, and we live by faith and not by sight. That's what he was saying. Man shall not live on bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Verse 5. Then the devil took him up into the holy city being Jerusalem, set him on the pinnacle of the temple. It's the most holy place in the city is the temple. And said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. Prove your sonship by special demonstration of God's protection. Be reckless and make a show of your power. He's trying to trick Jesus into taking a shortcut. I've seen a movie called The Miracle Maker where the devil had planted Jesus on the pinnacle of the temple. He says, throw yourself down. His angels will take charge of you. They'll catch you. And in The Miracle Maker, a vision formed in front of the Lord as if it would happen. And see, if Jesus threw himself off the temple and the angels did come, it would have been in front of whom? The Pharisees and the Sadducees. It's him! Messiah! Messiah has come. Offered him a shortcut. I'll give you you won't have to go through all this trouble, Jesus. You won't have to go through all this nonsense of the chosen people, the people they're meant to be of God. They will spit on you. They'll put you to death. But if you throw yourself off here and they see you being caught up by angels, oh, isn't that easier? Wouldn't it be easier if they just straight away knew you were the Messiah? They would listen to you. They would hang off of your every word. Jesus said to him, it was written again that you shall not tempt the Lord your God. You shall not tempt the Lord your God. We need to know our word. We need to know what the word says. You know, if anyone knows the word, it's him, the devil. He will try and manipulate and change things to fit his agendas. He'll even use familiar spirits to talk to you. I mentioned here that a familiar spirit talked to me about giving because I was blessed with money. And he says, you don't need a tithe and offer that. He goes, what you give now will supersede that anyway. It covers it. Don't worry, it covers it. Just enjoy it. And I'm like, you know, according to the principle, according to the word, makes sense. But then I tested the spirit. I said, did Jesus come in the flesh? And I heard nothing. It was a familiar spirit trying to use the word to have its way. Trying to kind of get in there. But I knew the word. I knew what the word says. Test the spirits. Ask it. Does it confess that Jesus had come in the flesh? And as we know, the devil can disguise himself as an angel of light. So you need to know your word. You need to know your word. Praise the Lord. Verse 8. And the devil took him up in an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to them, all these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. So the kingdom of darkness here, the kingdom of obscurity says, use my power and influence and worldly organizations and kingdoms to become great among men whom you seek to get power over. You can enslave and dominate them if you bow your knee and worship me. Verse 10, then Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. And then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to Jesus. In the kingdom of God, there is, you know, in here in this kingdom of darkness, people have power here. There are governments, there is the elite group here that are super wealthy. Things are being more and more exposed. If you've got your ear to the ground, things are being more and more exposed of demonic powers. Everything that's kind of happening out there is kind of festering and manifesting spiritual dominions and darkness. And so what the devil was offering Jesus, I'll give you all this under your hand, you can lead here. But the kingdom of God is different. See, when you excel here in the kingdom of God, your name won't be in Hollywood in bright lights. It won't be in the credits of the blockbuster movies. Well, maybe, but you know what I'm saying. The most powerful people on the planet are ones that you'll probably never even heard of. Because when you come under this kingdom, he places you over principalities and powers. In fact, they are under your feet. And so what Satan was trying to give Jesus was something that was lower than what God wanted for us and for mankind. He's trying to sell us short. Hallelujah. And so what we see here is that the character of the kingdom emanates from the character of the king. So the kingdom of the power of darkness over here has its God. God of the ages, principalities and powers. His name is the devil. He comes to do three things. Steal, kill, destroy. John 10, verses 10. And so we turn away from that kingdom and the cosmos, and we allow ourselves to be conveyed and translated into the light. Amen? Turn with me to Philippians 3 and verse 17. Philippians 3 and verse 17. Philippians 3 and verse 17, this is the Apostle Paul writing. He says, "Brethren, join in following my example and note those who so walk as you have us for a pattern. Join in my following my example and note those who so walk as you have us for a pattern." The way that we walk, the way that we talk, the way that we behave and live is different. Join us. Watch us. Observe. Let us be a pattern. Follow our example. Because it's different to the way in the kingdom of darkness here. The way that we give is counterculture. The way that we respond to our enemies is counterculture. The way that we prefer one another is counterculture. And so he's saying, follow my example. Watch me. Watch how I respond. Watch the way that I live. Watch how I give. Use me as a pattern. Remember, I believe it was 2006, I went to India with Pastor Colin. And I learned so much. Just, he didn't sit there and he taught me the whole time. I just watched the man. I just carried his bags, opened his doors, and just followed him like a disciple would follow his rabbi. And there are some moments and times where I wished I was just a fly on the wall, because they were quite uncomfortable. But there was some input in here that can't be taken away. Because, you know, you can learn so much from over the pulpit, but when you watch somebody as a pattern for living, that speaks to a person more. Their character, their conduct, the way that they act, who they are as a person. There is this old saying in the Jewish customs where it says, "Blessed is the one who is anointed by the flakes of his rabbi's sandals." Blessed is the one who is anointed by the flakes of his rabbi's sandals. And what that picture means is that he's following his rabbi around. And he's so close so that the flakes of his rabbi's sandals are being flicked up onto him. So you're following the man of God. And so what we see here is Paul saying the same thing. Join in my following. Join in following my example and note those who so walk as you have us for a pattern. Verse 18. "For many walk, of whom I've told you often and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ." This is quite a tragic and sad two verses. "Whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who have set their mind on earthly things." These people have backslidden so much so that they've become the enemies of the cross. They set their minds of earthly things. They've gone back into the cosmos from the kingdom here. They've gone back into the kingdom of darkness, back into a place of obscurity. Bewilders me sometimes. How can anyone that's kind of progressed and seen the light, have seen the curtains being pulled back, and say, "Oh, you know what? I don't want that anymore. I want to go back over here." Now, I know that people can get discouraged. I know that people can lose sight of truth. But what I noticed about some backsliders is that they walk worse than people that never knew Jesus in the first place. I look at some of the young people that go into Hollywood, have become famous at a really young age. You know, when they, at the beginning of their fame, they love the Lord. They thank Jesus when they win awards, and you know they're not ashamed of the things of the gospel. But now they've just, because the Hollywood machine chews up and spits out people, they've become enemies of the cross. There's a number of names that I could name, but I don't think, I've even written some down, but I don't think I will. And it almost seems like they can't get away from the light. There's a scripture in Isaiah that talks about the works of the Lord, who can reverse it? And so when they come back over into obscurity, they try and cover it up with the perverse deeds and they try and put the light out. So they do really gross and demonic things. Do you understand what I'm saying? Can you think of people? Don't say their names. So they bury themselves in perverseness and they become enemies of the cross. Verse 20. Let's turn from focusing on that and turn to focusing on who you are. It says in verse 24, our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working of which he is able to even subdue all things to himself. Your citizenship is in heaven. When you come over to this kingdom, your citizenship has changed. You are no longer a citizen of the kingdom of darkness. Your citizenship, in the Greek, it talks about community. Your community is here in the kingdom. Your name is in the kingdom. You are a citizen of the kingdom right now. Praise the Lord. I don't know, I thought that was good news. So our citizenship and your community supersedes your earthly belongings too. It supersedes even your biological family. Not many people like hearing this because family is super important to people. And you know what? Your family is super important to God. But it's not as important as your spiritual family. I'm going to say that again. It is not as important as your spiritual family. It has preeminence. God loves your unsaved family members, absolutely. But when it comes to priorities, your priority is with the family of God. You will be with us for eternity. And unless your family members get saved, there will not be. Am I saying too hard things? Should I lighten it up a little bit? It's quite interesting. Jesus was clear as soon as it came to the push to, as comes push to shove. One of his disciples came in during one of his meetings and says, Jesus, your mother and your sisters and your brothers are here. He goes, who are they? Who are they? Look around you. Here are my mothers, my brothers and my sisters, those that do the will of God. There was a clear distinction. What were they doing outside the meeting? If you were really my mothers, my brothers, and my sisters, you should have been in here listening to the things that I have to say. Your family of God supersedes your biological family. It is clear in the Word. And I've seen where people have changed the priorities around, where they prioritize their family. He says, you know what, I'm going to take Sundays off and spend some family time as if it was some holy thing. And I've never once seen it end well. They don't spend time with their family. They spend time in front of the television. Should I give you another one? Matthew 10 verses 34. I'll read it out to you. Just write this down. He says, I've not come to bring peace, but a sword. I will set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And as a man's enemies will be those of his own household. It's not the devil that's doing this. It's not the principalities and the powers. Jesus says, I have not come to bring peace, but I've come to bring a sword. There will be a clear division between you and them. He who loves his father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves his son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Who are my mothers and my brothers and my sisters? I remember when I first came here to Rhema, you know that I have a Catholic background. And my family wasn't staunch Catholics. My nana probably was, but my kind of started to water down by the time I got to my parents. But even my dad, my dad went to Hatupetera College. He wanted to be a priest for a season in his life. so they were kind of Catholics from both sides, came here. They didn't like me being in a faith church. They didn't like me being here with charismatic Pentecostals. And you know, I prayed about that, because being a young believer, you think, you know, what do I do? Would it be wiser for me to kind of side with my family? Maybe in some way I can kind of, you know, show them the light. But then I found the scripture, and it says, Jesus says, I have not come to bring peace but a sword. I come first. I have preeminence in your life. This kingdom that you're a part of comes before anything else, including your family. So I drew a line. I says, you know what? I found Jesus here in this house. I found a God that wanted to have a living relationship with me, and I'm not letting that go. My family, you can do what you want, but I'm staying right here. These here are my mothers, my brothers and my sisters. And you know what? It was not until you kind of, we look at these scriptures and think, far out, it's so hard to understand. But sometimes you just need to walk it out to see the fruit of it. And the fruit of this is that it is in love. It is in love for your family that doesn't know him yet. Because now they have a chance. Because you have anchored yourself in this kingdom. They are watching your life unfold and seeing its fruit, seeing the kingdom work and operate in your life. They now have a chance because you have put the kingdom first. You are an ambassador of the kingdom of light. I don't regret coming over into the kingdom of the Son of His love. And we will have struggle with our families. Jesus said that. You know, they will be set against you. That doesn't matter. We're on the winning team. We're on the winning side. And if you stick with the word and you stick with this family, then we have each other. God takes preeminence. His kingdom comes first above all else. Are you with me? And it is for the sake of the lost. It is for the sake of them. Praise the Lord. There is love behind those scriptures in Matthew 10. We don't see it at first, but it becomes apparent. The curtains become drawn back a little bit more. You with me? Yes. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, we just thank you for your word. It is health and life to us, and keeping of it there is great reward. Father God, I thank you for this family, Lord. I thank you for this kingdom that we are in. Father God, I thank you that you have conveyed us from out of the kingdom of darkness, from obscurity, and brought us into the kingdom of light. We see you, Father God. We see your fruits. We see prosperity. We see the way to live, Father God, and we choose this higher level of life. And Father God, I just worship you. We praise your glorious name, and we thank you for the blood of Jesus that has forgiven us of all sins. All sins. And we worship you, and we praise your glorious name. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to carry this on tonight at 6 p.m. Praise God, but please stay.